Hello. Welcome to a conversation with Professor Gary Cook. We are here in Chapel Hill, North Carolina on this day, March 16, 2010. Leaves on the trees are budding. Flowers are blooming. Spring is in the air. March Madness is upon us. It is a wonderful time to be here on the campus of the University of North Carolina. And what better way than to spend the next hour with one of its most beloved professors, Gary Cook. I am John Preisser, a research professor in the Department of Biostatistics, and one of many colleagues and former students who hold great admiration and affection for this highly accomplished professor. The high esteem in which Professor Cook is held was fully evident when the Department of Biostatistics held a festdrift in his honor this past October in Chapel Hill as part of a celebration of the department's 60th anniversary. Hundreds of participants came to honor Professor Cook and to hear technical talks and heartfelt tributes to their teacher, mentor, colleague, and friend. In a few moments, Lisa Lavange, professor of the practice in the Department of Biostatistics, will have a chat with Professor Cook. They have been colleagues for 25 years, Cook having co-chaired Lavange's dissertation in the 1980s. Today, we will hear of Cook's personal history and his passion for the field of biostatistics. Gary first came to Chapel Hill in the fall of 1963 to pursue graduate studies in statistics. He earned his doctorate in statistics in 1968, and upon completion was appointed assistant professor in the Department of Biostatistics, where he teaches to this day. A detailed biography, transcripts of this interview, and research articles will soon be published in a special Gary Cook Festschrift issue of the journal Statistics in Biopharmaceutical Research, a journal of the American Statistical Association. And now, Lisa Lavange's conversation with Gary Cook.
I'm Lisa Lavange, and I'm here with Professor Gary Cook of the Department of Biostatistics at University of North Carolina in Chapel Hill. Gary, I wonder if you could tell me what early experiences in your life or as a student led you to the field of statistics.
Well, in my early childhood, before I ever went to school, my mother used to drill me in mathematical exercises, adding numbers together, multiplying numbers together. And as an outgrowth of that, when I first went to elementary school, I had a lot of interest in math. I had very limited interest in reading or writing, but I liked to do math, and I was in a school where they encouraged that. And that continued on through high school, where I had some wonderful mathematics teachers who continued to encourage me to learn as much mathematics as I could and to enjoy it as much as I could. And that included doing some science fair projects in mathematics in Central Ohio, which is where I grew up. I then moved on to Ohio State University, where I did my undergraduate work. And I began there as a mathematics major. But as the mathematics got more theoretical, it became further away from my practical interests in how mathematics could be used in solving problems. And so I tried to find other fields in which the mathematics would have utility while still being interesting mathematics. And in my junior year, I took a statistics course, and my professor was Ransom Whitney, who is well known for what is known as the Mann-Whitney test for comparing two groups with one another in a non-parametric rank-based manner. The course was a very interesting course, but at about the midpoint of the course, he announced that there were jobs available in the statistical laboratory for any interested student who wanted to get more of a sense of what real applications of statistics involved. And so I then volunteered for one of those jobs. It involved adding numbers and multiplying numbers on a calculator. It involved taking decks of punch cards and putting them through a sorter to get frequencies of different outcomes on different characteristics that were being observed on subjects in different people's studies. Sometimes we would have to do what was called a cross sort, which meant you ran the card deck through the sorter one way, created 10 piles, and then you would run them through the cross sorter again to create a two-way table that would give you frequencies of combinations of outcomes. And so I got a lot of experience doing these kinds of things. I could view from a distance discussions between investigators doing studies in agriculture, education, biology, and Professor Whitney, trying to identify how statistics would relate to their particular studies. And I found this very interesting and very challenging and a very effective use of the methods that I had learned in the classroom. And it was, for the most part, from that point onward that I had a strong interest in statistics as a field that I would be potentially pursuing, at least in some form. At the same time, I was also doing a lot of coursework in operations research or industrial engineering, which also had a substantial statistical content. And that involved using statistical information so that companies might be more cost effective in some of their industrial work. However, when I later explored career opportunities, I found the career opportunities looked more feasible in statistics than in operations research. And that then led me to identify statistics as an area that I was going to pursue in my graduate study.
Then how did you end up in Chapel Hill in 1963? What brought you here for graduate school?
Well, that had a interesting pathway. Professor Whitney had identified Princeton as a place that I would go, although their program was more in mathematics with a statistical emphasis. I had identified Cornell as a place I might go because that still had the possibility that I could do operations research and statistics at the same time. North Carolina had been identified as a possibility for statistics, but it was not as much in the forefront as Cornell and Princeton had been. So when I had a spring break in my last year at Ohio State, I got in the car and I drove to Cornell. And it was 20 degrees and gray and blustery. And when I went to visit different faculty, they didn't really seem able to answer questions about the program and what I would be doing and where I would fit in and how it matched my general objectives of interest. And so then I got in the car and I drove on to Princeton. And I talked with a man there named Sam Wilkes, who was a very prominent faculty member in statistics at that time. And I said, well, I was trying to figure out Cornell, and I was also trying to figure out whether I fitted in here, but I don't think I really fit in here at Princeton because the emphasis is more mathematics, even though it is statistics. And I had thought a little bit about North Carolina, and I had applied there, but I really wasn't sure whether that would be a right place. And he proceeded to strongly recommend North Carolina for me. He said that if I went there, I would find that it clearly would match what my needs were. And so I proceeded to get in the car and drive down towards Chapel Hill. And as I got closer and closer to Chapel Hill, the weather kept getting better and better. I got to a hotel in Durham, which is not there anymore. It was in downtown Durham. And I spent the night there and got up the next morning. It's interesting that I could spend the night there because I didn't have any credit cards. All I had was a checkbook, and the checkbook was on an out-of-state bank. But back in those days, you know, if you looked like you were a college student, you know, visiting one of the universities in the area, you know, they were more than happy to take your check, you know, to pay for the room that you had that night. When I got up that morning, it was in the low 60s, the sun was shining, and I drove over to Chapel Hill. I went into town on Franklin Street, which of course at that time was just two lanes. I more or less somehow found my way to, I believe, where Franklin Street intersects Boundary Street, because I figured that the campus was off to the left somewhere. So I made a left-hand turn there and then was on Cameron Avenue. That was a typical spring in Chapel Hill. So in the 10th of March, all the flowers really were blooming and the trees were blooming and it looked very nice. And I remember sort of saying to myself, you know, if these professors can answer any question at all, you know, this is where I'm going to come. So I found a place to park my car, which was actually adjacent to South Building. They were pretty flexible on parking at that time, if you weren't going to be there for an hour or two. And they directed me to where the statistics department was, which was in Phillips Hall at that time. And I walked over there, and I was able to walk directly into the chairperson's office, a man named George Nicholson. And we talked for about 30 minutes, and he basically convinced me that North Carolina was the place to come. But to make sure, he then had me talk with two or three other faculty there. And I spoke briefly with them, and basically I said, I need some information on where you live and get a place, because this is where I'll be coming. I also indicated at that time to them that I was very much interested in having a work-study activity. And they had suggested that I talk with people in biostatistics. And so I had a meeting with Roy Keebler, who was a professor of the biostatistics department at the time, expressing my interest in a work-study activity, working in a laboratory like the laboratory that was at Ohio State. And he said, well, he didn't know what could be figured out at that time, but when I came back in the fall, something would be developed. And eventually it was developed with Professor Grizzle. And so when I started my graduate work in the statistics department, I also had a research assistantship in biostatistics working with Professor Grizzle. So it was sort of a roundabout process that got me here. It was in many ways pivotal, you know, on the advice I had gotten from Professor Wilkes, and the reason why I find that topic a bit sensitive is that he had died within 6 months of when I had seen him.
Oh. Now, when you were in Chapel Hill, you also took courses at North Carolina State University, is that right?
Yes, after I had completed my first year here, the curriculum was mixed. There were several courses that were oriented to the practice of statistics, which I thoroughly enjoyed. But some others were very demanding in terms of statistical theory, for which I had had some uncertainty about, even though I was okay in them. But I wasn't sure whether down the road I was going to continue to find that they were fitting where my interests were. And after being here a year, I became aware of a very fine program at North Carolina State, because at that particular time, there was an arrangement whereby the students at North Carolina State in an applications program would take courses in Chapel Hill, which would strengthen their underlying background in mathematical statistics. And then any number of students from Chapel Hill who were mainly in mathematical statistics would take courses in what at that time was called experimental statistics at North Carolina State. And so basically, when I found out that that was an opportunity, then I started taking classes at North Carolina State. So I took half of my graduate courses at North Carolina State and half of them in the statistics department at Chapel Hill. And I think I completed the coursework for the PhD at both places. And so I ultimately had to make up my mind where I would do my dissertation. But I had a major professor that I had worked with very closely, Professor R.C. Bose, who worked in an area called design of experiments, and ultimately I did my dissertation with him. But I found it very beneficial taking courses at both NC State that were very applications oriented, dealing with topics of variance components, linear models, and other topics like that to balance the coursework I had at UNC.
Now, upon graduation, you entered the Department of Biostatistics as an assistant professor. So what about biostatistics attracted you at that time?
Well, the biostatistics activity, of course, began when I started my graduate work in 1963, because I had a research assistantship there working with Professor Grizzle. And that activity had introduced me to a number of topics. These topics included crossover designs, where subjects will get one therapeutic regimen in an initial treatment period, followed by a different one in a subsequent treatment period. It introduced me to categorical data, where outcomes for subjects are yes or no relief, some relief, a lot of relief, complete relief. It had introduced me to Professor Sen, who had non-parametric methods, particularly non-parametric methods for studies where outcomes were measured multivariately at different points in time. And I had worked in areas where these methods were applied in public health and in medical sciences. So I already had a very strong interest in biostatistics all the way through the curriculum that I had had as a graduate student. What I had not mentioned earlier was that when I was doing coursework at North Carolina State, I ended up having meetings with Gertrude Cox, who was the founder of the Department of Experimental Statistics at North Carolina State, as well as the person who caused the Department of Statistics at University of North Carolina Chapel Hill to come into being as well. After getting the North Carolina State Department off the ground, she then worked with the Chancellor here in Chapel Hill to get the Statistics Department here in Chapel Hill created. And then through her, I met a number of people who had interactions with Research Triangle Institute, because Professor Cox actually had a role with respect to the evolution of Research Triangle Park, and in particular, Research Triangle Institute. And that led to me getting a part-time job at Research Triangle Institute beginning in the summer of 1966, where I worked on survey research methodology with Dan Horvitz, who in addition to faculty here at the University of North Carolina, was also an important mentor for me during that time. So I basically was then doing various types of survey research methodology at RTI, some of it funded by the U.S. Bureau of the Census. At the time, I was finishing my dissertation in what was called combinatorial methods for information retrieval with Professor Bowes, and having at the same time a research assistant position in the biostatistics department. So at the time I actually finished my dissertation, I had a part-time job at RTI. I also had a research assistantship in the biostatistics department. And then another opportunity that I responded to was a opportunity to teach two statistics courses at the Fort Bragg campus of North Carolina State University, which I did during 1967-1968. So I was sort of doing all of these things at the same time, and my wife Carolyn thought, you know, I needed to have a real job in one place as opposed to doing three different things in three different places, and an opportunity to become an assistant professor in the biostatistics department at the University of North Carolina evolved, and I accepted that, and I've been in that kind of faculty position ever since.
Well, those of us that know you well would not be at all surprised to learn that you were involved in several different things at the same time as a graduate student. And I think your father was a physician, and did that lead you to an interest in medical statistics or biostatistics, do you think?
Yeah, my father was a general practitioner osteopath, and that certainly very much interested me in medicine. And osteopathy has as one of its major themes prevention. You invoke strategies in terms of nutrition and lifestyle to try to do as much as you can to prevent illness so as to minimize the extent to which you have to intervene with therapeutic options to try to resolve an illness that happens. He also had a tendency to want to discuss aspects of the medical interactions he had with his patients in a generic way over the dinner table. And so we would often have many discussions about various kinds of medical management issues, disease prevention issues, health promotion issues as part of general discussion at the dinner table. And my brother Tad, who is a chemistry professor at the University of Colorado in Boulder, and I, as well as our mother, wanted to do as much as we could to keep conversations with him directed at what was going on at the office in terms of his medical practice, because most of the time his mood about that was better than discussions of his golf game. So he would often have the best discussions for what was going on at the office, and it was better unless, you know, he came home from a golf game with a big smile on his face and saying, "Let's go get ice cream." It's best not to talk about golf.
So back at UNC then, as a research, as an assistant professor in the Department of Biostatistics, you mentored a number of students, and in the early years, I know you had a good mix of statistical methodological problems for research as well as the application of those methods. And I wonder if you'd talk a little bit about how you see the interplay of methods and applications in the field of biostatistics.
Well, I had, of course, been stimulated very much by applications in practice when I was working with Professor Grizzle in the collaborative environment that he provided oversight for while I was a graduate student. And I saw how different questions from collaborative investigators motivated statistical thinking about strategies to address those questions, with that often leading to innovations that addressed new methodology. So that environment then continued once I was on the faculty. So when I had a faculty appointment, I continued to have collaborative interactions with any number of investigators. The investigators came from the dental school, where I continued to have a lot of collaborators. But dentistry is a very interesting area for biostatistics because, as most people know, dentists are very meticulous about observing data. When you are sitting in the dental chair, they're talking about various numbers and measurements on every surface of every tooth. And that information is inherently multivariate. And so there were a lot of statistical questions that came from there. I also worked with people in cardiology. I worked with people in oncology. I also, in the early years, had substantial involvement with the North Carolina Highway Safety Research Center, where one of my former students and colleagues, Don Reinfurt, had a position. But I also worked with a man named Bob Campbell, who was the founder of the Highway Safety Research Center. And in the early 70s at the Highway Safety Research Center, they were very interested as a major priority doing statistical analyses of administrative record files for motor vehicle accidents in North Carolina, as well as other areas, to show that people who at the time of an accident were wearing a seatbelt or a restraint system fared considerably better than those who were not. Because back at that time, there were not mandatory seatbelt laws, and there were any number of people who were very insistent about only wearing seatbelts or restraint systems when they felt like it, rather than doing it to prevent injury in the possibility of an accident. Those data were categorical data. They were outcomes of severity of injury when you were in an accident, together with the association of whether persons were wearing seat restraint systems or otherwise. And so that was a challenging categorical data problem, and that was one of my major areas of research. And so areas like dentistry, highway safety research, cardiology, oncology, identified any variety of statistical problems that I then would have my graduate students address for their dissertation research.
Now, you've mentored a number of students in your career. Students have always been an important focus for you. And recently, you and your wife, Carolyn, have established the Gary G. Cook Scholars Fund, which is meant to attract the brightest students to study graduate work at the Department of Biostatistics at UNC. I wonder if you could talk a little bit more about why supporting the students is important and what you see is attractive to students about studying biostatistics today.
Well, I've always thought of students as the central part of a university. Students come to a university with lots of enthusiasm to learn as much as they can, and they take what they learn into the real world to help make the world better. They make it better in public health by trying to enhance programs in public health that, again, address disease prevention and promotion of better health for as many people as possible, as well as trying to optimize whatever resources are available for health in terms of its invocation for benefiting as many people as possible. Students also are very effective in challenging professors to defend whatever a professor thinks. They're very effective in keeping people on their toes, as well as being the ultimate custodians of what we today know as we're able to pass it on to the next generation. So I consider students to be very central and also to be the people that are most in need of funding so they can indeed pursue their education and develop as much as possible. Moreover, in a program like biostatistics, if you have good students working with you, oftentimes you can attract funding from investigations in medical research or other areas of application. So as you fund students, you also enhance the ability to fund other aspects of the university community as well. And the whole process is very synergistic, but I always think of it as beginning with the students. If you didn't have students, you wouldn't have a university. And so basically, it is students that make a university what it is.
So Gary, you are 68 years old. You show no signs of slowing down. I wonder if you could talk a little bit about this passion of biostatistics that keeps you going and what you see for the future of biostatistics and what you think will happen in the near future or the long term in terms of you staying involved with the department and teaching and so forth.
Well, I think biostatistics, as well as public health, continues to be an area where there's important questions. Questions in terms of addressing the design of studies to lead to better treatments for illnesses, ways of having programs that reduce the risk of different kinds of infections or other medical disorders, whether it's alcohol abuse or drug abuse or vulnerability to sexually transmitted diseases that are major concerns for children, as well as adolescents, as well as other people. And basically any kind of innovation that is identified always will require evaluation. And biostatistical methods are a way of doing the evaluation of new public health programs. It is the way of identifying ways in which different aspects of the environment or types of lifestyle are related to risks of major disorders. So in the current environment, issues in nutrition are very much related to obesity in the population, that's related to other medical disorders that people become vulnerable to. When you're involved in public health and the medical sciences, there's an endless set of questions that need collaborative attention, and biostatisticians are very much needed so that the best quantitative methods in study design and data interpretation are available to make sure these questions are addressed in a fully valid and appropriate way. So there's an endless set of challenges that continue to arise and be worthy of attention. And I find, you know, discussing people's questions with them, discussing their strategies in design, discussing what the issues will be from complications in data, such as missing data, multiple assessments, other topics like that will continue to be challenging. And for as long as I'm able to do it, I will continue to do it. And another nice thing about biostatistics is that we constantly see new tools emerging, better ways to do the kinds of things that we have been doing in the past through the substantial enhancement of computer capabilities. So methodologies that were not available to us in the past become available to us in the present, and questions that we had thought about in the past and thought, well, this strategy might be available, but there's not the computing resources to do it. When we revisit those questions in today's environment or tomorrow's environment, there will be the computing resources to do it. And so basically, it is a field that continues to grow upon itself. And that creates lots of opportunities for the students in biostatistics, both now and into the future. and many worthwhile problems to address, and hopefully have some success with.
Is there anything else you'd like to say to students that might be listening to this interview at some point in the future about the field?
Well, the best thing about biostatistics is that it is challenging and interesting and worthwhile in its own right. It is doubly worthwhile in whatever fields of application you choose to address with it, whether it's cardiovascular disease, whether it's oncology, whether it's nutrition, whether it's better health promotion programs. You can change your area of interest and application on a year-to-year basis as new areas for application and collaboration become more interesting to you, and other areas where maybe you worked in the past, you decide you'll set aside for a year or two. So you constantly can be challenged and willing to pursue effectively any variety of directions in the health and medical sciences while still enjoying biostatistics for what it is.
Well, I want to thank you for talking to us today, and those of us that have had the wonderful opportunity to learn from you and work with you hope that you keep going strong for many more years in our department.
We'll keep trying to do it one year at a time.
Okay, thank you.
Bye.